Sean Cunningham from Fox 40, thrilled to be joined by a guy I know all too well, Matt Barnes, who just had a basketball camp in Sacramento, returns now to do another year of analyst work with the Sacramento Kings pre, half, and post game shows. And you got a really special event coming to Sacramento. But I want to start right there, Matt. You know, as someone who covered you as an NBA player and being from Sacramento as well, you were always very media, you know, savvy and great with the media and experienced all things in basketball. I wonder, when did it come on your radar to where you looked at the media game and said, you know what, I think I could probably do that and have interest in doing that?
To be honest with you, it never crossed my mind one time until a friend of mine who is an agent now, she told me, this is after I was done playing, she's like, you're always so well-spoken. Have you ever thought about being an analyst? I'm just like, nah, not necessarily, you know, because there's always kind of been a rift between players and media, some media. And it just never really crossed my mind, but she stayed on me. She got me a little gig at, I don't know if it was ESPN or Fox First, but one of those two respective networks. I did one show and I liked it. It's like, oh, this is not too bad. It's fun. And she's like, yeah, I think you could be good at it. And, you know, just started putting more effort into it, started studying and understanding the flow of the show and, you know, where I can be most effective in my approach. And, you know, from there, I've, you know, started in my media path. You know, I've been in media now for 5 years. I've been retired for six, been in media for five, and it's been fun. You know, it's been a learning process. I have a lot of respect for the media now, just kind of understanding the BS from us or for former player or from players that you guys have to deal with on a daily basis. But, my whole goal, of getting in this media space was to allow players to feel comfortable speaking to the media. You know, I feel like the more that athletes get into it and kind of set the tone and kind of have an understanding for how athletes move, whether current or retired players, I think it kind of helps everybody. So I jumped in, I've been having a blast, and, you know, the media career has taken off.
You say about the players, and I can admit, as a media member for over 20 years, we're no walk in the park either.
Right. And I mean, and that's the thing. I mean, but someone like you, you know what I mean? You've always been real. You've always been upfront. You've always been respectful. And you and I have had a great rapport, you know, since the time we've met. But there's other people that take certain angles or may have the wrong energy that could just at the wrong time, rub a player the wrong way. And there's a rift. You know what I mean? And then as a player, I'm going to say, I don't really mess with that person. And then that's how it kind of starts going through the locker room. And so it's just a lot of different moving parts that go into the conversation between players and media. And I think now that more former athletes are kind of getting into it and we have a different perspective of how much time you have to put into the media side. It's not like you could just show up and smile and be fine. You know, there's a lot of work you guys do to prepare for this, just as players, how we try to prepare for our job. So again, really kind of during this journey, along with learning a lot, I just have a lot more respect for people who are in the space.
Well said, man. I appreciate you saying that. It means a lot. I mean, I think about, you know, the athlete, especially in the NBA, who transitions to the media side. And I think the poster child of it might be Charles Barkley. And one of the things he, much like yourself, you always speak from the heart. You're honest. You don't really sugarcoat much. But he has an interesting look on it where he feels that, you know, because of that, you know, he has to call spade a spade. And I wonder, is that a challenge that you meet yourself and how maybe that may backfire at times? Cause I feel like you play that game pretty well. Yeah. And I don't think I think Charles could probably play it a little bit better. I'm not trying to talk mess on him. I'm just saying, like, he thinks that it's going to ruin him or hurt him at the end of the day to have relationships with players if he can't speak the way that he feels.
I would honestly say that's the toughest part about transitioning as a player to the media space is having to be critical. You know, much like Charles, you know, I've never really been one to hold my tongue or, you know, sugarcoat anything. But I just think that there is a way, and I don't know when this line was crossed, but I want to say it was crossed maybe in the last 6, 7, 8 years, to where, you know, some media members have taken, instead of kind of critiquing the X's and O's or the performance, they started taking shots at the man or at the woman or at the person instead of kind of critiquing the job. you know, what we're doing, our performances. And I think that kind of opened the floodgates. But unfortunately, some of those people were rewarded and given a lot of money and kind of moved up the totem pole for wild takes that weren't necessarily right, but they were first, or they weren't necessarily like a good thing to do, but it got a lot of views. You know what I mean? So I think really the hardest transitioning point for me is finding a way to critique, because we have to critique my former colleagues, and without being disrespectful. You know, I think there's just a way to, hey, you didn't play well, and there's a way I can form that or show examples of that without disrespecting the person. And I think as athletes, that's what we don't like, or that's what I didn't like as an athlete. It's just like, you know, obviously our job is, you know, one in a billion, you know what I mean? It's a unicorn to be able to play at these professional levels across, you know, all the major sports. And I remember I didn't used to like how people who didn't play or couldn't play would critique with the personal attacks on the person instead of critiquing the game. So, you know, I don't know when it went astray, but that's one of my main focuses now being a former player is being able to critique without disrespect. But at the same time, I have colleagues that used to play who will jump in and disrespect the person, not the player, again, not the player or the performance, which is unfortunate. So I think everyone kind of has their own approach. And like I said, I think now more than ever, the disrespectful, loud, personal attacks are being rewarded. And I feel like some athletes coming into this space feel like, okay, well, I need to raise my voice, or I need to be disrespectful to be heard. And to me, it's quite the contrary. I mean, I think if you know the game well enough and you can articulate your way around the game, that there's plenty to talk about without having to disrespect anybody, period.
Yeah, that's well said, man. And I think about when you have this podcast that has become really, in my opinion, one of the, if not the pillars of sports podcasts, especially in the NBA with you and Steven Jackson. Obviously, we're talking about All the Smoke, and it's an unfiltered look at sports and conversations in general. And I, as you know, I've been a fan of it. You've been able to bring it here to Sacramento. Is that a fine line to walk though, when you have a podcast like that and then also have to have a more cleaned up approach to be on a studio panel, like an ESPN or even a team? Like, how do you kind of walk that line?
Those are night and days, and I have to catch myself holding cuss words back sometimes because I freely speak and I'm a free cusser. And it's funny, I was talking about this about, you know, I was on a panel the other day about, because I'm a stepdad or a bonus dad, and I can say a cuss word to my biological kids and they don't, you know, this is like, oh, that's just dad telling us to get downstairs and clean, you know what I mean? So I say all that to say, like, there is a different line. It's a different energy. Obviously you want to stay true, real, and authentic, but you know, there's just a lot more freedom in the podcast space. And I think that's, you know, honestly what makes, you know, Jack and I work. You know, we don't have the same approach to media. You know, Jack is someone that will personally attack people sometime. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's like, that's kind of his thing, and he'll have his reasons for doing it. And I don't want to necessarily agree with it, but I don't have to agree with it. You know what I mean? I think that's what makes, you know, our combination and our ability to play off each other work. And that's not to say that, you know, that he hates the person or hates, but that's just kind of how he'll portray his messages by kind of sometimes, you know, saying some stuff. I'm like, damn, that was a little harsh. You know what I mean? And sometimes I say like, yeah, you're right. You know what I mean? But, again, that line of being able to get through to people and get people to open up. And I think that's what makes All the Smoke so special, is that we've created an environment where people realize that we're not going for clickbait. We're not going for a hot take. We just want to have a real, genuine conversation. And I feel like through those real, authentic, genuine conversations, the viral moments will happen. You know, we're dropping James Worley today, and people have been going crazy just about the way he talked about the 80s. And it wasn't anything that we made him say crazy or he threw anyone under the bus. It was just being able to have someone feel comfortable enough to like share, you know, James Worthy is one of the greatest power forwards of all time, but he's on our podcast talking about how he needed escorts to have sex and to make him feel special. And when I sit back and see that kind of stuff, I'm just like, man, I know he hasn't told anyone this before, but he feels comfortable enough to say it here. And that's what I feel like I'm most proud of, is we've created an environment where athletes, entertainers, musicians can comfortably speak their mind and get stuff off their chest as if they're having a conversation with their friends or family.
Yeah. And I wonder, you know, the first time that happened, when you had your podcast, your show become a viral moment, become a news-making moment, did you ever think that that space that you do this show in would become what we like to call aggregatable? You know, it's in the aggregate, and people will aggregate your content and link to it and say, look, you'll never know what this person said, or you can't believe what this person said. Do you remember the first time that that happened? And did you think that it would be that type of show to where it would happen on the regular?
I didn't. First of all, I didn't even know what a podcast was. I just knew that right. For Jackson and I, who two guys who are habitual line steppers, that we would just have a little bit more freedom to kind of be us. But literally our first viral moment was our first episode with J.R. Smith. And he talked about the stuff that happened with the Cavs in the finals. And he hadn't opened up about that and really addressed it yet. And next thing you know, you see it on ESPN. And I'm like, oh, shoot. Okay. You know what I mean? And then another network picks it up, and then it's a viral moment. So it was a humbling experience, a really cool experience. I kind of get chills talking about it right now, because it takes me back about 4 years and really right when we started, but it's been interesting. And now you see, you know, left and right. And again, I always say, you know, I always want to give, you know, love where love is due. And D Miles and Q Rich to me were the first two in this NBA space to start with knuckleheads. But when we came, I think we kind of took the space by storm. And really kind of started showing other, particularly basketball players, but I have NFL guys all the time, like, I want to make my version of all the smoke. So just encouraging guys to, you know, utilize their platforms and their voices. You know, for the history of sports, it's always been other people telling our stories. And I think what All the Smoke has done is open the doors for guys to realize, like, hey, I can tell my own story. I can help my brother and sister tell their story, and I can encourage others to do the same. So, you know, from a standpoint like that, it's almost like and I don't say this to be disrespectful, like the big pillars of media will always, the Foxes, the ESPNs, they'll always be there now. But most of the time people are going to tune into these podcasts, whether it be mine or Draymond's or Paul George's or Pat Bev's or JJ Redick's. You're getting information that you wouldn't necessarily get on these bigger networks when you actually just sit and listen to players or former players and players or players and players have these conversations.
Yeah, you have these people who are following your footsteps. Can you think of a guy back when you played? And it feels weird for me to say that, back when you played, as if it was that long ago. But but when you think about podcasts, like, can you think of a guy you're like, oh man, this guy would have been a natural as a podcast host?
Oh man, that's a great question. I mean, you think of someone who's charismatic. I mean, Charles Barkley, you know, obviously he's in the space now and he jumped into media, but can you imagine just kind of if he was new and this kind of unfiltered and off the cuff the way he was? You know, Magic Johnson is another great talker, but it's always kind of sometimes it's guys you wouldn't expect, because I think on the outside looking in, and people look at the NBA and they saw me and they saw Steven Jackson, they'd be like, huh? Kind of the same way that Showtime kind of looked at this initially. Like, the funny story at Showtime was when I pitched them the idea, they weren't sold on Jack. They're like, oh, okay, we'll give you a show. And, you know, how do you want to do this? How do you want to do that? And when I'm just like, no, I don't want the show unless I can bring my brother with me. You know what I mean? So sometimes it's not necessarily the big names. It's a lot of the times it's the unexpected people who have kind of seen it from different levels. You know, a superstar only has a superstar kind of point of view. You know what I mean? As a role player, which I was, I've seen the superstar. I've had to sit on the bench. I've started, I've been cut, I've been waived, I've been in the D League, I've been in the G, you know, my journey has been a lot different, which I think kind of made me more well-rounded and appreciated every moment once I really got my foot in the NBA. And I think I use all those past experiences to pull from, also my childhood and my off the court life, to try to be the best interviewer, analyst, ear to someone who wants to tell their story.
Oh, that's great. 5 seasons now, All the Smoke, and you've got a number of live shows. And I was fortunate to attend one here in Sacramento with Jason Williams back in April. Mm-hmm. And you told me then, I mean, first of all, that was quite an undertaking at Urban Roots. And we're going to do it again this Saturday with Mike Bibby. And I wonder what your observations were now, looking back a few months later and reflecting upon that, to where you are coming into Saturday, because I remember you telling me that you had some ideas of doing something like this around the season, and true to your word, here you are with Mike Bibby right before the season starts.
First and foremost, it's just, you know, I'm just a Sacramento guy at heart. You know, Sacramento, you know, I came to Sacramento at 8 or 9 years old, and you know, kind of the hard knocks, the good, the bad, the in between. But still a Sacramento person at heart, you know, although I haven't lived there in maybe 15 years, home is always going to be where the heart is. So I always try to find ways to come back to Sacramento. I can't thank the Kings and NBC enough to give me the opportunity to do a little bit of analyst work for the team. And now the team's doing well, which makes it even more exciting. But, you know, outside of that, bringing opportunities, bringing experiences back to the city is always something that's been on my mind. You know, you and I talked about it when we did J. Will last year, that I wanted to come back and do more. And, you know, I didn't really have to talk them into it, you know, because the team is good now and everyone wants to be a part of something that's good. You know, I told them, I was like, we need to go do, you know, some preseason stuff with the Kings. You know, I think I got some connections there that would kind of give us some access. And I connected a few dots, and thank you, Shannon, who's the head of PR over there. She's always been great and welcoming. And I hit her up like, hey, you know, I want to come and sit down and talk to Mike Brown. I want to come and sit down and talk to, you know, a few players and kind of just shine a different light on Sacramento, because I think it's time to do that. And they were very receptive to it and very exciting. So, you know, our day starts tomorrow. I fly out there tomorrow. I think everyone flew out tonight, gets there tonight, but I got to do an event tonight out here in LA, but I fly to Sacramento in the morning, go straight to practice, you know, get to mingle with the team. You know, we're going to do a round table with three of their players and then also get a chance to sit down with Mike Brown, which I think is great. And again, shine a light on this team because they deserve it. You know, I can't say enough good things about management and, you know, bringing Mike Brown in and the moves they've made and how excited the city is, because again, being from Sacramento, I know how important the Kings are to Sacramento. You know, there's not a ton of stuff to do out there, but when the Kings are good, you couldn't tell that city nothing. You know what I mean? So I'm really excited for the city, for the team. And, you know, that leads us into Saturday with, you know, Mike Bibby, who is arguably one of the greatest Kings and most beloved Kings in the history. And, you know, we're going to have a great time out there at Urban Woots. And, you know, I'm sure you'll drop all the information on how they can get tickets and how to be a part of it. But, you know, that's not it. I want to do something again come playoff time. And I want to, you know, I've been working on someone who Sacramento loves to death. He's hard to move. He's hard to get a hold of, but he's my OG and my big brother. And I really want to bring Chris Webber back to Sacramento, you know, at the end of the season for the playoffs and do a live show with Webb. So I've been dropping little nuggets here and there and bothering them here and there, telling them I need to get him out there. So I think hopefully, fingers crossed, that, you know, come playoff time, I'll be bringing Chris Webber back out to Sacramento to not only enjoy the playoff experience, but also have a live show for all the fans.
Yeah, if you thought pulling Jason Williams was tough, I think that one was probably tougher than Webb, because Jay Will doesn't come back to Sac that often. And when he does, it's not well known.
Yeah, no, Jay Will's really quiet behind, and similar to Webb. Both these guys, I mean, they just kind of appreciate their privacy, and I respect that, you know, but being kind of a younger player under both those guys' wings, along with Mike Bibby, you know, I was always with those guys and had a lot of great times on and off the court. And, you know, I knew how much Sacramento, really how much the world loves white chocolate, and to be able to get him out and get him out of his little cocoon out there in Orlando and get him out to Sac was dope. You know, obviously Mike, you know, someone, him and Jay were traded for each other, and Mike came and took the team to another level. You know, I thought what was interesting about that interview with Jason Williams, I don't know if you recall, but when Jason Williams said the Kings made the right move by trading him and picking up Mike, because Mike took them to that next level. And that's not things you hear from former players all the time. But again, people feeling comfortable enough to really speak their mind is what I love. So, you know, Jay Will set the tone in Sacramento. Mike Bibby's going to take it to another level, and I'm really excited for Monday.
Saturday, yeah, and you've known Mike a long time. It brings me to a place where I go, you know, I know how close you are to him. How do you interview him? Is there anything you've never asked him before that you're going to try to bring out of him?
I mean, our production team's going to come up with a great run of show. And then obviously Steven Jackson too. Steven Jackson knows Mike, if not maybe better than me. You know, Mike opened up his home to Jack when he was going into the NBA. He actually lived with Mike Bibby for like 3 months because Jack was going to go to Arizona. Some stuff happened and it didn't end up working out, and he went overseas. But, you know, Jack and I both know Mike very well, but also know Mike is a very private guy, you know what I mean? So we're going to, you know, pick and pry at him and poke at him a little bit to really kind of open up, because again, I know how much Sacramento loves Mike Bibby and appreciate, you know, what Mike did for this team and for the city, and how that team got cheated by the refs in the Lakers series. So there's just a lot of fun stuff I think we're going to have fun talking about. And again, just giving Sacramento experiences that they normally don't get.
Yeah. Comes up Saturday, urbanrootsbrewing.com. I believe doors open at 1:30. urbanrootsbrewing.com/ATS, all the smoke ATS. That's where you get your tickets. And it's going to be a lot of fun. I think the show starts at 3:00. Doors open at 1:30. You got food. You got drinks. You got some extracurriculars that are now not so frowned upon in society, because All the Smoke is a cannabis background of a show as well, and that plays a part. So I love that. I love that the stigma around cannabis has, those walls have come down, especially in California, because you do see the benefits for athletes, and I think you're a big part of it to bring that to the forefront in sports especially.
I appreciate it. We worked hard on that. That was, you know, you talked to me about how media came about. My first goal post-retirement was being a shield for current athletes in cannabis. So I was making trips myself, Al Harrington, we were making trips to New York, talking to the NBPA, talking to the NBA, just how can we change this? This, everything is outdated. You guys need to do your research. And slowly but surely, again, we're not the reason why it changed, but I like to think that we're a small reason that kind of, okay, we lit the light bulb in the right people's head. Okay, we do need to go out here and research this and really start to understand this plant instead of going by old stigmas and stereotypes from the 70s and 80s. So really happy that guys, you know, use it responsibly now. And it is an alternative form of medicine to not only help NBA players, but NBA or NFL. Major League Baseball as well. So really excited that the stigma has been lifted and people have educated themselves on the plant, because I feel like that plant can help everyone from our children to our grandparents.
Yeah, absolutely. And the science is behind it. And you guys are a big reason why. I look forward to seeing you, Matt. Can't thank you enough for coming on here. I look forward to seeing you Saturday. And of course, as we get this season underway, I know there's a lot of big things scheduled for the Kings this year and a lot of high hopes. And I imagine you've got some high expectations for them.
Definitely. You know, this is an exciting season. You know, obviously, you know, the 16 years of mediocrity has come to an end, and again, now you thank management for that, but then, you know, they put a group of players together, and you know, I think I've been talking a lot in this preseason, the Kings didn't make a lot of big moves. To me, I don't really think they had to. They re-signed their key guys. They're going to build on the experience they got from playing the Warriors in 7 games in the first round next year. They got Sasha, who I know is going to bring a lot to the Kings team, and all these younger players have a year under their belt. So I'm really excited to see, you know, what Mike Brown has been able to do with this team in the preseason, and what kind of product they're going to put on the court this season.
Yeah, not bothered by an 0-2 preseason. People forget they were 0-4 to start the season, right?
Yeah, none of that stuff really matters. You know what I mean? Preseason doesn't matter. As players, but we don't care about, like, it's just about getting the rhythm and the chemistry down with your guys and understanding that you're going to go through ups and downs, but you got to stay consistent more times than not. And I know this team understands that, and I'm looking forward to a big year from this team.
Absolutely. And we'll be seeing you on NBC Sports Bay Area and California with the Kings coverage. Thanks so much for coming on, Matt. We'll see you on Saturday, and hope to see a lot of people out there again.
Thanks, Sean. Appreciate you, bro.